Hello and welcome to the Redesigning Wellness podcast. This episode is a bit of a unique one as my guest brings two strengths, communications and coaching. Today's guest is Marina Calabrese. For 17 years, Marina built a multifaceted communications function with a leading medical professional liability company in Raleigh, North Carolina. She literally built her role and continued to make it grow. Marina specialized on communicating to employees during acquisitions. She has worked with integration teams to guide employees through the acquisition process while maintaining transparent communication, stability, and making change less disruptive. What she realized was that times of change can make even the strongest leaders feel vulnerable. And when they are feeling vulnerable about their roles, it can be challenging to project calm professionalism to their workforce and to keep them focused on the work at hand. So Marina decided to get credentialed in an organizational and executive coaching training. And so her future state kind of looks like blending her two worlds by helping companies develop effective communication strategies for managing organizational change. So in this interview with Marina, we discuss the importance of companies clearly communicating to their employees, how she made her case for building her role into having greater responsibility, and how the work with an integration team helped influence employee communications during times of change. She tells us more about what a coaching approach means for an organization and leaves us with a tangible tip, both around communication and incorporating a coaching approach. Now, before we dive in, of course, I want to invite you over to our Facebook group, the Redesigning Wellness Community, where like-minded wellness professionals get together to help each other with resources, networking, if we have a specific challenge going on. It's a very helpful group. And so we'd love you to join us. You can just go to Facebook and search Redesigning Wellness Community. And I ask you a couple questions to make sure you are a bot and, of course, relevant to our field. And I will let you into the group. All right. I have to admit, I am recording this intro at about 10 o'clock at night while I'm on vacation. So if I'm a little bit underwhelming right now, that is the reason. Hopefully you can't tell. The kids are asleep. I'm trying not to wake anyone up, but want to make sure I get this episode out on time. All right. So anyway, come join us on Facebook. And let's go ahead and dive into my interview with Marina Calabrese. As always, thank you so much for listening to the Redesigning Wellness podcast.
Hello and welcome to Redesigning Wellness, your go-to podcast for making the most of your corporate health strategies. Your host is Jen Arnold, corporate wellness consultant. With over a decade of experience in promoting worksite health, she'll help boost your wellness program to one your employees are sure to enjoy. And now, here's Jen.
Marina, welcome to the Redesigning Wellness podcast. I'm so glad to have you on today.
Jen, thank you so much for having me. I'm really excited to be here today.
Yeah, no, I'm really thrilled because you bring really two skill sets to this conversation. So I'm going to start with kind of how you started and your background in corporate communications. And communications is a huge aspect of employee wellness, which I'm sure my listeners know about. But I want you to talk about it from like the importance. What's the importance of companies clearly communicating to their employees about anything going on?
Sure. I'd love to talk about this. Well, my experience has been that internal communication is actually the most actionable aspect of employee engagement within an organization. You know, the resources are often in place, yet many companies choose to prioritize external communication because they perceive a more direct tie to revenue generation that is not necessarily as obvious with employee communications. Now, fortunately, companies are recognizing that this was an incorrect assumption and that a well-functioning internal communications program can actually motivate and unify employees to work toward a common goal. You know, and informing the workforce regarding the why significantly engages them in the what. Mm-hmm. So part of this shift is based on growing data and research available to illustrate the value of internal communication. In the past, we've had a lot of data available about external communication. Now we're starting to see some of this data become available in the realm of internal. And I think that really speaks to senior management of many companies. So fortunately, we're starting to see more emphasis there. At the end of the day, employees want to know their goals. They want to understand the plans for getting there, and they want to feel confident about the value of their contribution towards those plans. You know, they want to feel valued, listened to, and like they're part of the team. You know, so in response to this, you know, organizations should establish interactive and reliable channels to reach all employees. And in my experience, interactive meant transforming from more traditional, one-directional communication modes to being more progressive, using a real-time, two-way platform that fostered an ongoing dialogue, trust, and transparency. So examples of these new channels, just a few examples, intranets, which I think a lot of companies have had intranets, but making them be less static and more interactive, microsites, e-newsletters, video, social media. These are all the new ways that companies are trying to communicate with their employees. And I think part of what's driven this is that many companies have remote staff, and these are great ways for remote staff to stay involved and informed.
When you say two-way conversations, you know, in some of these things, I'm just thinking like the intranet's pretty static, microsites. Has there been a way that you've worked to actually get employee feedback? And so it is a two-way conversation between employee and employer?
Sure. Well, with intranets and microsites, a lot of them now have the feature, it's almost like a blog feature, where they can respond and post comments or ask questions. And for remote staff, this is a great opportunity since they're not on site to have these face-to-face conversations. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, it does. I was just thinking back. It's been a couple of years since I've been in corporate, but I think we did have an avenue because our Zone was the main thing that people went to. It was a great... I was fortunate. I worked at a company that had a very large internal communications team, a lot of support, especially pushing out, you know, employee wellness communications. Yeah. So I've always been... mostly been in a company that had these resources, but I've also worked with companies that had none of these resources. And there, you know, the communications were going out kind of haphazardly. You mentioned data that supports having internal communications. What's some of the data that you've seen?
Well, a lot of these platforms offer data. And so being able to drill into it to see how employees are accessing the information that you post, that's one way. And then the other way that I think has grown to be a very popular way to take the pulse of your workforce are engagement surveys. And that was something that we did annually. And those engagement surveys yielded a lot of data on, you know, what's important to employees, what do they need in order to do their jobs well, what's missing. So the combination of the data that you could harvest from your platforms, your digital platforms, and then actually trying to understand the nuances of that data by surveying your workforce and together creating a story around why internal communication is so important has become easier than it was when you were doing more traditional forms of internal communication without the ability to really look at the performance.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I guess I didn't think about it that way because you're looking at how many people are accessing the site, how many people are posting, those type things that you typically, like as an entrepreneur, about who opened your emails, the percentage, and you know like how many people are going to your website. You know all those stats, but I've never really thought about it from a corporate communications perspective.
And I think even beyond that, I think more and more research is becoming available. More and more entities are doing research on internal communication as more data becomes available. And so there's just more white papers being written on the topic. And so there's more opportunity to just learn about why it's important.
So how did you make the case for you over the years? Because you have the unique experience of building it for the company that you worked for. And so you've seen different aspects of the role from starting it to leading it. And how did you make the case to continue to build it throughout the years?
That's a great question. Well, I'll tell you, I had to make it carefully, thoughtfully, and with sound judgment. And I did my homework. One of the first things I did when I realized maybe I needed to broaden my skill set was to seek extra training and education to ensure that I was equipped to propose changes to the communications function that, you know, that aligned with the company's overall growth. And a big part of gaining the autonomy to expand the function was based on building strong relationships, you know, with employees at all levels. And I think ultimately that helped to foster some trust. And I also looked for opportunities, you know, to network outside the organization with other communications professionals to gain insight on how their companies integrated communications function in their structure. And so over time, I earned the credibility to make the case for a more robust communications program and became an active member of the management team, you know, which kind of gave me a seat at the table. The company responded to my desire to be a valuable contributor by entrusting me and the communications team to rebuild the function to encompass all aspects of communication. So internal, external, PR, media relations, branding, and so on. And ultimately, what this did was shifted our stance from being reactive to proactive and much better positioned to serve the company and its external audience with timely and meaningful communications deliverables. So, you know, the proof was kind of in the pudding. You know, once we put these pieces together, we were just operating so much more efficiently and effectively.
Yeah, and I want to just kind of underscore what you said is that you noticed you sought out information. You weren't waiting for it to come to you, you know. And I'm very curious about what you saw as your gaps, because you said the first thing you did was realize that you needed some extra training. Do you remember what that was, or kind of how you realized that you had these gaps?
I did. Yeah, so much of my career was spent focused on traditional communication, so hard copy. Not so much on digital, because if you think back, this was 12 years ago, and this is just when digital media was becoming such an important component of communications for all organizations. So all of my education and training up until that point had been really more focused on traditional communications modes. So I enrolled in UNC. UNC at that time was offering a graduate program in communications and technology, and I, you know, spoke to the company about participating in that program. And I was very lucky that they endorsed my participation. And I was able to really just gain such tremendous insight on how digital media factored in to the changes that were happening in communications. And so that was really pivotal.
Yeah, well, I admire you for that, going out to seek the information and then the building those relationships, because I think that plays such a factor in a lot of people's success that we don't talk about enough. So even, you know, the ones internal to the organization, but also outside, and doing some networking there.
Yeah, I think it's really important. I mean, I think it's key to be able to step outside sort of the silo that you're used to working in and really understanding what's going on in other places. And there's just so much tremendous insight to be gained from that. So networking with other organizations to me is a key aspect.
Mm-hmm. Now, when you were advising senior management, because you were working with the senior team, did they understand the importance of internal communications? I'm assuming that over time, just like as you've built it, you had to convince them that it was worthwhile and it was important to keep building. Did you do anything specifically to accomplish that?
Sure. Well, I mean, to begin with, they understood the concept of internal communication. And I think they had a growing appreciation for its significance. I think when it became increasingly relevant to the senior leadership was when market conditions started to change for our business. And there was a really strong call to action for all employees to start thinking innovatively about how the organization needed to evolve so that it could maintain a sustainable business model and growth trajectory against some challenges. And this was the perfect opportunity to step up the focus on employee communication. You know, timing was certainly a key factor in making the case. Some of the ways we did it, and data was used, as we discussed earlier, data was used from our communications platforms and from those annual engagement surveys to illustrate the rationale in a meaningful and tangible way for expanding the internal communications program. And I also shared best practices and insights gained from those from that program that I took. I actually did a research project focused on internal communication and how it ties to better performance, better engagement, and ultimately successful business outcomes. Shared that with the management team. And I continue to bring back best practices from my networking with other professionals in our industry, I continue to serve on marketing and communications boards, just so that I could bring back to our team, how this was looking successful in other places. And, sharing these learnings from these external relationships with the communications and management teams, and then working collaboratively to figure out which strategies made the most sense to support the success of our customers, our employees, and to attain the goals. So, that's a very tight explanation. There were many, many things that went into it, but those were the most important pieces.
Yeah, and the reason why I asked that question is because sometimes senior leaders don't understand the importance of communicating to employees. They're very outward focused, right? So they're thinking of their customers as the people who are buying from them. And it sounds as though, and correct me if I'm wrong, that it was really an external driver that you needed employees. They needed employees to think differently in order to stay competitive in the marketplace. Is that correct?
That is correct. I mean, that definitely was a pivotal moment for, kind of pulling in that rationale for why it was really important for the whole workforce to be engaged, to ask without understanding their informational needs, to me, wouldn't have worked. And fortunately, they did understand the importance of involving every single person in this quest, so I have to say it was very well done between some in-person town hall meetings and then just the ongoing follow-up communication. It was a success story, and I think it really helped in the future to make the case going forward for why this always needed to be a part of the communications umbrella.
Yeah, and I think it's just important for my listeners to understand that making that connection, if communication is something that you're advocating for, like bulking up internal communications, kind of making that connection to what matters most to senior management. And
yes.
A lot of times it's customers, right? It's kind of the business. It's not just because employees need it. It's more of aligning it with what's important to them.
It started off like that, but I have to say that from that period forward, it really did become also focused on what was good for the employees. And, soon after that, we started to bring in a wellness program and, a broader and more robust community outreach program. So the other pieces came with it. And, yes, you're right. I mean, I think you're absolutely right, Jen, that sometimes it will be something external that'll sort of tip that scale. But it's really important for communications professionals to be ready when that opportunity is there, and even to anticipate it, so that you can move the organization in the direction that it needs to go with internal communication.
Right. And I love how you got the ball rolling, and then it just kind of kept going and going. And it was all really for the benefit of the employees, and they saw the overall benefit in it in many different facets.
Yep. Yes.
Now, one of the things I found this fascinating that you were helping with communication for were through some mergers and acquisitions, which are always, emotions are running high in general, and that may be an understatement, but how did you work through those? Like when you were thinking about these mergers and acquisitions and you're putting your communications together, how did you address the emotions that were probably underlying?
Sure. Well, I would say, just to speak specifically about the emotions, I would say that, among the top were anxiety, fear, uncertainty, insecurity, a little frustration about the changes, some curiosity about, what was going to happen with integrating this new group of employees, and some excitement about the possibilities. And certainly there was pride. I think both organizations had a strong sense of pride about what they had accomplished separately. So, but to the credit of the leadership of both companies involved in the acquisition, they knew that the success of the transition rested on the support of all employees. They also knew that building a solid engagement strategy had to go beyond the financial projections and the org charts to include empathy for what people were feeling and to foster positivity through some very difficult changes. So very early in the acquisition planning process, the company set up an integration team whose purpose was to serve as ambassadors and sounding boards for change and to provide all employees, you know, with regular updates on the progress at each phase. And I was fortunate to be part of this team, which was comprised of managers from each of the functional areas. And we worked closely together to anticipate the impact on all employees, including their questions and concerns. So if we have time, I mean, I could walk through, I have, you know, sort of a series of things, steps that we did, if we have time to talk about that.
Yeah, like go for it, might as well.
Sure. So we provided proactive and transparent communication in advance of major steps. So we didn't wait until the contracts were signed to start sharing details about the process and changes. And then we thought it would be really helpful to create a live FAQ document with milestones and real-time updates that helped employees to feel that they were in the know.
So Maria, let me interrupt you real quick. Were you guys like a pretty transparent organization? Because I imagine you would have to be to some extent to start talking about things before contracts were actually signed.
Yes, but I think there was an acknowledgement that to keep people in the dark, first of all, that never works because ultimately things leak out.
So, right.
You know, it just and rather than have misinformation circulating, it was much wiser to just right from the beginning, talk about why the acquisition was being carried out and give as much detail as you could. Certainly, there were instances from regulatory perspectives where we, you know, we couldn't share all the information, but as soon as the information could be shared, it was shared.
Gotcha.
I have to say, to the credit of the company, yes, this was a very transparent process.
Okay, sorry, I interrupted you. Go on.
It's okay. I think I left off. We had created a live FAQ document with milestones and real-time updates that helped employees to feel that they were in the know. You know, we wanted to make sure they understood why the changes were being made and that all the communication going out was intentional, you know, that it provided clarity and that ultimately it eased any worries or concerns that were floating out there. You know, and we also had to recognize in this process that we were working with an audience that came from two different corporate cultures, and each was accustomed to communicating in different ways. So we had to be sensitive to, you know, trying to come up with a versatile communications plan that adapted to both cultures. And we listened attentively to the concerns of both groups. You know, we thought strategically and compassionately about what they needed to hear and the best way to deliver that information. So.
Yeah, I like that concept of the integration team. And how long did that team last, like throughout the acquisition or merger?
Well, it started, you know, very early in the planning phases. I would say it lasted 2+ years.
Wow.
Because not only did it go through the actual integration, through the actual acquisition process, but so many important things happened post-acquisition. You know, that's when the real work begins. You know, that's when you have to start addressing cultural things. And, you know, just now you've got this, we had a remote workforce that was in another state in the mid-Atlantic. We had to figure out, you know, how to have the intranet expanded to address their needs as well. And so there were a whole host of things on the back end. So I would say it was more than 2 years that that team was in place.
Well, that definitely shows commitment because, I mean, I imagine some people would just kind of assemble it and be done and then everyone goes about their way. But yeah, the real work does happen after it's actually in place. And that's when you have to work out the hard stuff.
Exactly. Exactly.
So how did you transition from this background in communications and obviously this love of communications, which shows from just you answering these questions, but how did you transition into coaching?
Good question. Well, you know, it was actually because of my work on the integration team during that acquisition process. It really helped me to gain clarity on my passion, on my skills, and on my strengths. And in many ways, it tested my abilities as a communications professional, and it provided me with great insight on how I showed up and could make a difference, especially during times of unprecedented change. For much of my career, I had worked with a young team and spent most of my time mentoring and championing them to be successful. And I loved that aspect of my role, and I found great meaning and reward in seeing them grow and thrive. And, you know, also I served as a confidant to several colleagues and enjoyed helping them navigate challenges and issues. I realized after I left the company and had time for introspection that one of the main reasons I was sought out in this way was because I was genuinely curious and I listened actively without judgment most of the time and had a positive outlook. You know, I cared for their well-being and offered guidance that empowered them to address their challenges and goals, but I didn't try to solve their problems for them. So I think that helped to build some really solid relationships. And then when we arrived in Seattle, I took time to step back and thoughtfully consider and research next steps with my career transition. And I actually began working with a professional coach who has done an amazing job of empowering and challenging me as I step back to figure out my next role. And part of what I discovered in myself on this journey was a strong desire to help organizations unlock the full potential of their workforce and to really achieve a vibrant and engaged culture that is sustainable through times of change. So yeah. Having lived through 6 months.
No, I was just thinking, like, it just shows you the power of listening. I think people, they're listening, just waiting to talk. It sounds like you were actually listening and not trying to solve their problems, but really just trying to be a sounding board, if anything.
Right? Yeah. Well, yeah. And having lived through significant changes in the workplace and on a personal level, I've come to appreciate that a coaching mindset really helps to create leaders and organizations that are more authentic, that are agile, that are empathetic, and that are inspired to meet all types of challenges that inevitably come up in the workplace.
Right. So I'm thinking about, like, when these people are going through big changes at work, well, we'll just use the merger and acquisition situation. So that's happening. And you're thinking about communications. What else would an organization put in place to help navigate the change? I mean, communications are one thing. The integration team is part of that kind of network. But how does a coaching approach fit into that?
Oh, that's a terrific question. Well, you know, I think a coaching approach fosters vulnerability. And certainly when you're going through times of change like this, everybody feels vulnerable. So it fosters the vulnerability, the trust, and the influence, which are all critical for best ideas and innovation to come to the surface. And it establishes, a coaching approach establishes deep personal connections, which are instrumental to employee engagement, collaboration, and retention. And I think coaching helps employees rally behind a company's vision, certainly to understand the mission and the core values. And coaching accelerates an employee's leadership development. You know, a coaching approach really fosters a learning culture where employees are empowered to discover solutions on their own or as part of a team.
Okay, so before we go any further, let's define a coaching approach. I'm just sitting here going, people are going to be like, what the hell is a coaching approach? What does that mean? Break it down for me, Marina.
Sure. Yeah. And honestly, this can serve two purposes. It's sort of going to factor into the tips that I recommend in creating a coaching approach. So, you know, I think the coaching approach, what it is you're creating an environment of trust and intimacy with employees. And this naturally aligns, we go back to the original beginning of our discussion, it naturally aligns with employee communications. So you show your team, your coaching presence by listening well, not just to them, but to yourself, by being curious, by being courageous, by making strong connections, by having clarity on your purpose and their purpose, and by operating with truth and with grace, knowing when to support your employees and when to challenge them, how to balance inquiry with advocacy. And a big part of that is coaching the person and not the issues. And I think about that particular thought, it strikes me that that would be something that's so important in the whole cultivating well-being. You know, you're coaching the person, not the problem.
What does that mean, Marina? I don't really get that.
What does coaching the person and not the problem mean?
Yes.
Getting to understand the individual, their values, how they function, how they think, and not just the specific challenges they're dealing with. So what things cause them stress? What things help them to be successful? What is in their mindset? And how do you work with that to help them to become the best version of themselves in the workplace? Does that answer your question?
It does. And so when you think about support versus challenge, it doesn't mean that you're not necessarily challenging people. It just means that you know when to do it.
Yes. And that comes from active listening and, you know, and just paying attention.
Mm-hmm. So what does that mean in an organization? Let's just say you would go to an organization and implement some kind of coaching, a coaching approach, like you're trying to shift the culture into one that would include a coaching approach. What does that mean for an organization?
Well, I mean, it gets back to what I started with. It's creating an environment of trust and intimacy with employees. And this is through showing vulnerability. And also, I mean, a key aspect of that is the internal communication and just having that two-way dialogue and not the directive sort of approach where you're giving orders rather than helping employees to see where they fit in the ecosystem. So it's a shift, you know, it's a shift from, in many traditional, more hierarchy based organizations, it's a much more directive environment. Well, this is really about stopping and listening to the needs of your workforce and to understanding the culture and then to creating a culture where you're fostering and empowering them to really be, you know, part of the crusade of all the things you're trying to accomplish together. At the end of the day, it's about empowerment. And yes, there are times when you have to balance that with, you know, advocating and challenging them and maybe putting some experiments in front of them to help them to grow and to learn. And then it's also equally important to continue and grow as a leader to learn and grow your own emotional intelligence, your social intelligence, and your understanding about how human systems work within your organization. And I think at the end of the day, you know, you're building an alliance and you're creating an agreement and agenda with employees as you empower them to be that best possible version of themselves.
What kind of success can be seen from implementing a coaching approach? I mean, obviously building trust and intimacy, but for an organization, what would be the benefits?
Well, I think you're empowering your workforce to be autonomous and to move independently of you and to work with you alongside you and your partner. It's more of a partnership than it is of a top-down focus. And with that, I think organizations are far more agile and efficient and positioned to respond to change, you know, to grow. So there's a level of autonomy that you're giving to your workforce that allows leaders, as an example, just not to have to be so hands-on in that process. I think that's a big part of the benefit of the coaching. Also, I think it's really helpful for the entire workforce to understand that leaders are compassionate and vulnerable. And with that, you know, there's sort of an affiliation that develops and a stronger relationship that develops. And I think a willingness, you know, to be innovative, to think innovatively when you feel safe, you know, when you're working in a culture where you feel safe and you're thriving. I hope that makes sense. I kind of rambled on there a little bit.
You're good. You know, what's coming up for me is, like, I'm just thinking about managers who this would feel very uncomfortable for, right? They're used to being the ones being the, you know, kind of giving out the directives and people responding. How do leaders get past that if they just got this deep greened, like, I am the authority figure? How can they get past that to adopt a coaching approach?
Well, I see a real role here, maybe for human resources to help educate the organization on the benefits of coaching. I mean, I think it's about education, just like it was for internal communications. It's, you know, helping to walk them through the process and what the advantages and benefits are to the employee. And ultimately, if you've got a really healthy and engaged workforce, the organization is going to thrive. And it's just helping them to understand that. And maybe part of that, you know, could be, you know, having coaching consultants come in, which I know here locally, Microsoft is an example. They have regular coaching consultants come in who work with their management teams to give them the training to be coaches. you know, so it would probably be something that would be facilitated, you know, by the HR function, but there's that opportunity to bring in education and workshops so that organizations can come to understand, you know, how coaching will make a difference in their culture.
Yeah, I like the fact that you mentioned Microsoft, because like when you think about that, if I'm just stereotyping, I wouldn't think that they would be putting in something like a coaching approach. I think you just by saying that normalized it a bit, which is
they really are. I mean, honestly, they have taken it to a level that's impressive. They are going through the entire organization and offering that coach training to so many of their managers.
That's great.
And it is. And I think they have seen a huge shift in their culture. And when you think about the size of that organization and, mm-hmm. and things that they've accomplished, and it's to their credit that they recognize that even with tremendous success, there's always room for improvement and a change in the mindset. So.
Right. Well, since you have two different skill sets, I'm sure many, many more that we didn't even talk about today, but I'm going to ask for two tangible tips. Since we're already on the coaching approach, let's start there. What can they do to incorporate a coaching approach in their organization? And I don't mean in the traditional sense of health coaching, because I imagine there's some health coaches listening going, I do this already.
I'm going to end up repeating some of what I said before, but really it comes down to creating that trust and that intimacy with your employees. And this naturally, like I said, naturally aligns with that whole communications piece. You know, showing them your coaching presence, listening well, you know, being curious, making strong connections, having clarity on your purpose and theirs, knowing when to support them and when to challenge them. I mean, these are all repeats of things that we've talked about, but these are the tips.
One thing that when you just said, listen with curiosity, again, want to like just highlight that to my audience, because sometimes we have a tendency to listen, but still do what we want anyway. Like we're not really listening to say, oh, that's an interesting idea. Let me see what I can do with it. They're kind of like, oh, that won't work. Let me put in what I think should work. And I'm guilty of it. Like, so I think that listening with curiosity, just want to underscore it about how we could all, including myself, get better at it.
Oh, there's no question. I mean, making that shift to not just hearing, but really taking in what they're trying to say to you can turn out to be such a tremendous learning opportunity. So absolutely. Mm-hmm. I think that's key. And you're right. A lot of times we're listening, but we have our own agenda, and it's really letting go of your agenda and being open to someone else's thoughts can be mm-hmm. very valuable.
Absolutely. Now, what about with communication? What can a wellness professional do to more clearly communicate with employees?
Sure. Well, I mean, I would say first and foremost, you have to know your audience. You absolutely have to know who the people are in your audience. Listen actively to their needs and communicate early and often. Be direct, honest, transparent, so that employees are prepared and excited about what you're trying to accomplish together. And when you're thinking about which channels to use, bear in mind that email, intranets and microsites, e-newsletters, and face-to-face are still cited as some of the most popular and effective channels for internal communication. And that there are some emerging channels like video, certainly video and podcasting, all are becoming huge. Internal social networks are gaining traction and are likely to feature more prominently as communicators become more comfortable with using them. And finally, I would say just be creative when it comes to making your communications more available to employees. Give them the option to consume your information in a way that suits them. You know, by offering employees a choice, you empower them. It shows that you respect their time and their preferences, and that immediately makes your communications more engaging. So hopefully these are helpful and useful takeaways on internal communication.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, Marina, how can people get in contact with you if they wanted to reach out?
Sure. Email is great. You can reach me via email and I can provide that. It's mfcalabrese52@gmail.com. And then also I'm happy to chat via telephone, 206-485-8318.
I'm always so
surprised, delighted when people put it, surprised and delighted when people put out their phone number like that. So thank you.
Well, no problem.
Well, Marina, thank you so much for your time. I really appreciate it.
Well, thank you so much for having me, Jen. This was a great conversation. I enjoyed it.
There's been a lot of news and media attention lately about stress and job burnout. If you're trying to solve this problem with stress balls and those lovely stress dots that you get at health fairs that, you know, react with your skin and change colors, it's time to try a different approach. Redesigning Wellness offers an impactful resilience training that teaches employees how to thrive in the fast-paced, continuously changing environment that is corporate America. We take a multi-dimensional approach that not only includes the physical, but also emotional, mental, and spiritual dimensions. I love giving this training, and the feedback has been tremendous. For more information on resilience training, visit redesigningwellness.com.